morning, everybody. Thank you so much for joining us on a very beautiful Saturday as we salute to the dogs of war. You have a really interesting program today. You'll learn some history. We will celebrate with the dogs who are serving our community now and many who don't have it in them. I would like to introduce representatives from the Valley Corral who will be providing us with the patriotic spirit through song today. Oh, there we are. Thank you. Very good. Before we continue with our program, I'd also like to recognize and thank Mr. Malcolm Barr for his spearheading this event for our 2 years in a row, as well as providing the funding and idea for this beautiful memorial garden here at the Humane Society, where we are very proud to play host for such a honorable thing to think about, which is very near and dear to Front Royal. I'm sure you'll hear all about that today. I would like to ask you to please join us in standing for our national anthem.
Three, two, four.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hail at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous flight o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof to the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled banner yet
thanks very much to you all. You may be seated. I'd like to give my own short welcome to you all and thank you for coming out today for this, I like to say, unique occasion. Our ideas for this yard go back to 60 years, when I was a correspondent in the Mid-Pacific and was stranded on the island of Guam at the height of the Vietnam War. I discovered on Guam a dog cemetery in a jungle clearing. It was a cemetery which contained the headstones for 22 war dogs that were killed in the opening stages of World War II. The cemetery was under the auspices of the U.S. Air Force. We uncovered while we were in the jungle clearing, which was very, very quiet, but overgrown. We uncovered headstones for three of the dogs. That got me thinking, and this is 60 years ago, I'm 90 now. It got me thinking that there ought to be more done for the recognition of the value of the dogs who are saving our soldiers by the hundreds in the battlefields. I had this on my mind for all of these years until 2 years ago, and frankly, I had saved up enough money to get the garden here situated, and the shelter was kind enough to provide the ground. I'd like to call on now, or at least I'd like to introduce our speaker today, if I can find my crib sheet. Pardon me, I thought I'd got everything here. I'll do this without a script. I've misplaced my notes. Sorry about that. Sorry about that. Our speaker today is driven in from Washington. He's one of the leaders of Voice of America. And years ago, he and I shared employment with the Associated Press. He was on one side of the world and I was on the other at different times. But we came together about 2 years ago in Front Royal when he and I became acquainted through an Associated Press newswire for retirees. While he and his wife were here a couple of years back, Steve was fascinated by my story of this Garden of Remembrance, which led to me inviting him back 2 years later to come here today to give the keynote speech for all of us. Steve, unfortunately, his wife isn't here with him, but she's the, I think, the dog lover of the family. But she's here in spirit and is watching us right now at her parents' home in the Himalayas on her cell phone, I presume. Anyway, Steve, let me call on you to come up here and talk to us for a little bit. And I thank you for coming all this way this morning. I know you had to get up early. Ladies and gentlemen. Thank you.
Thank you, Malcolm. Good morning, everyone. Special note to Megan, everything you've done. Councilman Rogers, Reverend Jordan, who we'll hear from in a bit. It's an honor to be here in Warren County with you on this Memorial Day weekend, a time of remembrance and tribute to the brave heroes, two-legged and four-legged, who gave their lives in service to these United States. And I'm very humbled that Malcolm, my former Associated Press colleague, asked me to speak here. And I'm very much in awe of all the work he's done over the decades, bringing attention to the service of our canine friends. I'll talk a little bit about that more in a moment. As an occasional public speaker, I know I always risk being heckled, but this is probably the first time that I've been howled at while I've been at the microphone. As I stated this weekend, we not only honor the human heroes who have sacrificed so much, but also the relatively unsung heroes who have more than a century served alongside them, without whom many of their missions would have been impossible. The loyalty and dedication of these dogs is unmatched. They have proven time and again they are willing to put themselves in harm's way to protect their human handlers and their fellow soldiers in fights, of course, they really cannot understand. They have saved countless lives through bravery and tenacity, and their contributions have not gone unnoticed. Dogs have been taken into battle since the time of the ancient Greeks and Romans. The earliest historical reference we have to dogs in combat were those who broke through enemy ranks ahead of cavalry charges of the Ephesians in the mid-7th century BC. Other military leaders throughout history have also realized their value. Attila the Hun, for one. There was the 15th century Vietnamese emperor, Le Loi, who had a pack of 100 warhounds. Frederick the Great of Prussia used dogs as messengers during the Seven Years' War with Russia. Napoleon had service dogs among his troops. Dogs participated with U.S. forces as early as the Seminole War, and hounds protected soldiers, guarded prisoners, and dispatched messengers during our Civil War. In modern times, it was apparently the Germans that were first documented to use dogs in combat during the First World War, the Great War. The Allies soon followed suit, and by the end of the war, tens of thousands of dogs had served on both sides. The dogs were used for a variety of tasks, such as carrying messages, detecting mines, and providing security. In the Second World War, dogs were used by both the Allied and Axis forces, and their contributions were even more significant. They were used for search and rescue missions, detecting bombs and explosives, and even as sentries. Some of you may know that the Warren County Remount Center trained the first dogs of war in 1942 for service in that conflict. And I mentioned Malcolm earlier. He was not one of the trainers here in 42, at least I don't think so. But he did play, as he mentioned, a subsequent, an important role during his AP assignment on Guam after the war, when he came upon the graves of military service dogs in the jungle overgrown with vegetation. He was upset to see these conditions of these graves. And he actually went up, he didn't mention this, he went up the Department of Defense chain of command all the way to then Secretary of Defense Robert McNamara. So we really have Malcolm to thank for what would become the National War Dog Cemetery, which was opened ceremonially at the U.S. Naval Base at Orote Point on Guam on July 20th, 1994, which was the 50th anniversary of the invasion of Guam. The site includes the grave for a Doberman named Kurt, who is credited with saving the lives of 250 Marines when he warned them of a massive Japanese force ahead. Kurt was badly injured in the ensuing mortar attack, along with his handler, Private First Class Alan Jacobson, who is said to have refused treatment until Kurt had been taken out of harm's way. Unfortunately, Kurt became the first of the war dogs to be killed in action on Guam. After World War II, dogs continued to serve in the military as well as in law enforcement and search and rescue operations. I believe we have one of the Warren County canine police dogs with us today. I believe is a narcotics dog, so check your pockets. These dogs, of course, have a keen sense of smell, agility, and intelligence that makes them valuable assets in military and law enforcement operations. But it's not just their skills and abilities that make these dogs so special. It's their loyalty and devotion to their handlers that truly sets them apart. They are willing to put themselves at risk of harm to protect their human partners, and their bravery and selflessness are an inspiration to all of us. As we honor the memory of those who have fallen in service to our country this weekend, let us also have a special remembrance, as we're doing here today, for the dogs who have served alongside them. They are canine heroes and comrades. Their loyalty and devotion earn them special places in our hearts, and we must remember to be forever grateful for that service. These canines who have served man so faithfully may be gone, but their memories live on, and their legacy and service hopefully will inspire generations to come. Thank you.
Call on the Reverend Mark Jordan to bless the animals. Mark comes to us from my Rotary Club. He's a retired minister in Front Royal, and I welcome him here today.
Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, in your glory and your grace and love, you created this wondrous world that we live in. You created all creatures, both great and small. And although we sometimes fail to realize our connection with all of your creation, today we stop and pause and reflect on that special connection that we are made aware of so often, and how the animals around us enrich and enhance our lives. We also remember the awesome responsibility we have to care for them. And we thank you for them, O God. We acknowledge that this world can turn brutal and tragic, and that so many of your beloved creatures suffer with abuse or abandonment or starvation or pain. We ask you would bless them, O God, and help us to bless them. And we thank you for this place that seeks to be an instrument of love and grace and kindness and compassion for these animals that are so important to us. Today we especially remember those dogs that have been in service to not only the handlers, but the world. We pray, O Lord, that as we remember them and celebrate them and are inspired by their love and their devotion, their service, that you would bless them. Lord, we pray that your Spirit would help us to understand more fully the mystery and the wonder of our connection with the world around us, with the animals around us. And may these war dogs and these dogs of service serve to remind us of just how magical this connection is between us and them. For they are your creatures, and we ask that you would bless them, guard them, and keep them safe, and help us to be instruments of that love and grace and compassion as well. For we give you our thanks for all of this creation, for all your creatures, human, for all your creatures, great and small, for the life that you've given us. We give you our praise and our glory. Amen.
Thank you very much for that, Mark. I'd now like to call on Councilman Skip Rogers, who himself was a U.S. Army dog handler in the 70s, I believe it was. Skip, I've asked to lay the wreath, which is here, to honor the dogs of war and the dogs of law enforcement, and to, may I take this opportunity to welcome law enforcement to this ceremony today. And I'll ask Skip now to join with the police guard of honor and place the wreath at the on the rack.
Thank you.
Present arms. Order arms. Withdraw.
Thank you. And I'll now ask the, excuse me, ask the Valley Chorale to present America the Beautiful.
Good.
I wanted to thank you all for coming. Thank you. Yes, that's the Valley Chorale. Thank you for being here and making this such a special event. I wanted to thank all of our participants and our guests for joining us today as we celebrate the dogs who've served in war. We welcome you to join us inside for refreshments as well as guided shelter tours. If you're not familiar with our work here, we'd love to talk with you about it. And again, I'd like to thank Mr. Malcolm Barr for making today's event possible and highlighting something that we are all very near and dear to our heart. The dogs do so much for our lives here on a day-to-day basis, but also for our country. And for that, we're very thankful. I appreciate you all joining, and I hope you'll stick around for some refreshments. Thank you very much.
Well, that concludes our ceremony, and I thank you all for coming. I hope you'll take advantage of taking a look at our facility for the dogs and the cats. We've got cats too. There's a limited amount of food on the table just inside the shelter entrance. There is water there for you if you are overheated, even if you're not. But once again, thank you very much, and a special thanks for the police department to Chris O'Connor for coming over today and joining us, and specifically for Olivia the dog handler and the dog whose name escapes me at the moment. But thank you, Olivia, for coming to join us. With that, thanks again, and same time next year.
Five minutes like so.